Hello and welcome to our Tittle-Tattle Show. I'm your host, Sana, and today I'll be bringing you all the latest news about film, music, and series, and we have some exciting news to share with you. Starting with Tei Shi is back with a new album and producing music on her own terms. The Colombian-Canadian singer's battle with her first record label led her to take a brief hiatus from performing in 2021. Valeria Teacher, better known as the stage name Tei Shi, is a Colombian-Canadian singer, songwriter, and producer. Growing up between Bogota, Colombia, and Vancouver, she draws inspiration from her cross-cultural identity and a dynamic background. Having broken out of a toxic exchange with her label followed by pandemic complications, she took a hiatus from her music to reflect on herself, organize her priorities, and redefine herself as a musician and a person. Her latest EP, Bad Premonition, establishes Tei Shi as a fully independent musician with a passion to express her self-fulfillment in overcoming the pain of being restrained as an artist. In advance of her concert at Soda Bar, Tei Shi spoke, "When I first started putting music out and performing as Tei Shi, I started from a really very DIY place where I just threw some music online. I was living in New York and I kind of ended up unexpectedly having these opportunities come my way and starting to build my project as Tei Shi out. Once I signed my first label deal and entered that reality, I experienced a lot of obstacles just in getting my music out and having to fight a lot for the music I wanted to make. I had to kind of learn to navigate the realities of being tied to a company that has own changes and own inner workings, stuff that you have no control over as an artist. I had to explain myself and convince people to believe in what I wanted to do. I experienced a lot of questioning of whether it made sense for me to have my music out in Spanish and music in English, and have it live within the same project and a lot of pushing up against our dated idea. So definitely, kind of had my share of frustrations and disappointments with that, but once I was able to get myself to finish out the initial record deal and get myself into a new situation, I unfortunately ended up in a very similar situation where I basically realized that I just couldn't release music without somebody else's approval. I ended up stuck in my career a few times because of that. Having to really explain myself, really fight for what I wanted to do, and not be heard created this situation for me where I had several kind of starts and hops in my career. I ended up in these standstills for several years because I just wasn't fully given the freedom of what I wanted to do. There are so many things that are already working against you as an artist that are working to stir you up a bit of your own agency and own certainty. Because of doing that, it makes you an artist feel like you need all these other people in your life. You need the stamp of approval, you need this label deal, you need these things to compete you or to make you feel like a real artist. There's a lot of us who have insecurities, a lot of things at play already in an industry kind of contributes to artists feeling insecure or like they need these certain things in order to succeed. So when you have that, you're somebody that's trying to get out there and succeed with something that's so personal to you and so sensitive. Then there's very easy for people to come in and it's very easy for people to take promises and take over. I think as artists, it's quite easy to relinquish that control to other people because it's convenient. It's like we just want to be in the studio making music, making art. We want to be artists. We don't have to be worried about other things. We already feel like maybe we can't handle those things or understand them. There's already so much that's not transparent in the industry that we get overwhelmed and it's very easy to hand off control to somebody else. Maybe you're lucky and you end up with people around you that are really the right fit. How did I end up here? But at the end of the day, I think it's really easy for you as an artist to lose control because you want to help and people are excited about you, which makes you excited. You think people are going to bring up all these things. I think it's just kind of like a recipe for disaster in a lot of ways. Following up, Kim Petras says Nicki Minaj's verse on Alone changed my life in so many ways. The German pop princess gave an update on her forthcoming major label debut album. "It doesn't feel like it's still real," said the rising star, who told Zane Lowe on Apple Music One. "Her singing, it's Barbie and Kim Petras," I cried. I was on the floor and she called me Kim Petty in it. which all of my friends are like, how do we not come up with that our entire lives? So she's just changed my life in so many ways with that verse and the verse riffs. I love her and I'm just so inspired by her always. It's crazy to me. I don't know how she does it, but she's just the greatest ever. The recent Billboard Music Honor went on to gush about shooting the music video with Minaj for the dance influence track, which samples Alice DJ's classic 1990 club banger, Better Off Alone, calling the experience the best thing ever. Alone is set to include it on Petra's long-awaited major label debut album, Wire Republic Records, a project that the German singer teased is finally on its way in the wake of the first ever Grammy win for her Sam Smith collab Unholy. The Grammys were just a few months ago and it really changed my life in a big way. So it's crazy that this year started out with such a bang for me, and then Nicki jumping on the song was just one of the greatest achievements of my life. It really sped up my album and how people finish it, and it's done now. Yeah, it's done. It was time to say it. Karol G dominates Latin Music Awards. Karol G was the big winner at 2023 Latin American Music Awards on Thursday night. The Colombian artist clinched 8 awards in total, including Artist of the Year, Tour of the Year, Streaming Artist of the Year, and Best Song, Pop for Provenza. Karol, real name Carolina Giraldo Navarro, was absent from the event. However, her mommy collaborator Becky G was on her hand to accept the award for the Song of the Year and Collaboration of the Year for their Girl Power anthem. This is bigger than us. This is the Girl Power. Thank you to the fans for supporting us, said Becky, real name Rebecca Gomez, during her acceptance speech, reports Billboard. Becky took home 4 awards in total. Elsewhere during the ceremony, Bad Bunny won Album of the Year and Best Album Urban for Un Verano Sinti. Among other prizes, and Canadian R&B singer, The Weeknd was named Best Crossover Artist. He also won the Collaboration Crossover of the Year Award for La Fama, his song with Rosalia. Shakira was also a double winner, taking home prizes for the Best Artist, Pop, and Best Collaboration, Tropical for Monotonia with Ozuna. The 2023 Latin American Music Awards took place at the MGM Grand Garden Arena in Las Vegas. Rita Ora, meanwhile, says husband Taika Waititi changed her forever and inspired new album. Rita Ora has spoken of her how her marriage to Taika Waititi changed her forever and that her husband inspired her to write music again. The Kosovo-born singer has been teasing her third studio album since 2019. After releasing launch single You Only Love Me, in January she announced new album You and I and released a new track Praising You, featuring Fatboy Slim earlier this week. Ora says she had a low period in her musical career where she lost a lot of confidence and a lot of hope. She spent so much time fighting to be heard that she hit a breaking point. I guess it's when at your lowest you can make a choice. You either kind of get back up and keep going, or you let it consume you. And I did that. I got up, I flew to Australia to do the voice over there, and I met somebody who changed me forever. Rita Ora then spoke about how meeting actor and writer Taika Waititi, now her now husband, who she married in 2022, had changed her forever and helped her get back to making music. I definitely never felt that love before, she said, and so I just wrote it all down and thought, okay, I think it's time to make some music again. The What We Do in the Shadows and Jojo Rabbit filmmaker Waititi, previously featured in the voice memo that opened recent single You Only Love Me. In a statement about the new music, Ora previously said that You and I means a lot to her. It's like my diary from the last few years. It's my sound and it's just true to me who I am today. You and I is set to be released on July 14th, BMG. Now let's move on to some film news. Guy Ritchie's The Convent, a gritty hard war film, best known for its tough talking blokes with gun, British gangster films, Guy Ritchie switches things up with the Guy Ritchie's The Convent, an oftentimes riveting war film which makes a new path for the 54-year-old filmmaker. It's not that Ritchie hasn't Zach before why there was a swept away with Madonna and the Sherlock Holmes movies and Aladdin. And on the second thought, maybe it's the best to not talk about movies he didn't make with Jason Statham. But The Covenant is wholly different. It's a sober war film about America's war in Afghanistan that acts as a tribute to the interpreters who put their life on the line to help American soldiers in exchange for an exit out of the country via US visa. That's the case of Ahmad, who is hired by a squadron headed by Jake Gyllenhaal's Sergeant John Kinley. It's March 2018, deep into the US occupation of Afghanistan, and Kinley and his men are tasked with locating the Taliban-made IEDs, a thankless, fruitless mission since when one side goes down, another pops up. The bigger issue of the war and the frustration of the US soldier on the ground colors the background as Richie focuses on the relationship between Ahmed and John as they're stranded together deep inside enemy territory. When John is wounded, Ahmed makes an impossible journey across the desert terrain, carrying John to safety and saving his life in the process. It's not until John wakes up at home in America that he realizes all that Ahmed has done for him, and he goes about the arduous task of repaying the debt he owes his brother in arms. Note the use of impossible world, since The Covenant is a fictional tale, not only based on any kind of true story. Even though Richie very much bases his story in reality, based on any kind of true story. Even though Richie thinks that it helps clear up any sort of misconception about the supersized heroics on display, as well as his ability to order up a satisfying ending for his character, one that may have been tougher to come up in real life. But Richie, with his second film of the year, following last month's Operation Fortune, is a skilled action filmmaker, and he makes full use of the tools in his arsenal to create a gritty, hard-fought war film with the purpose Gyllenhaal and Salim dig in to find the souls in their characters, grounding film and giving audience characters to root for, who embody the film's theme of trust, honor, and loyalty. Maybe Richie doesn't need Statham after all. Meanwhile, Hugh Jackman's Wolverine in Deadpool 3 is a divergence from the X-Men films and something completely new, says Ryan Reynolds. Hugh Jackman has promised fans that his return as Wolverine in the upcoming Deadpool 3 won't screw with the previous X-Men timeline. In other words, Jackman's Wolverine character arc from 2000's Men to Logan is safe from whatever will go down in the Marvel Cinematic Universe parallel. Neither Reynolds nor Jackman have disclosed much information about the new Wolverine, but Reynolds recently told ED Canada that it diverges greatly from Jackson's previous Wolverine. "We've wanted to do this for decades. It's weirdly the perfect time," Reynolds said about teaming up with Jackman. "I never stopped trying to get him to come back as Wolverine. I was just pestering him like gnat over the last many years. I believe in timing as much as with hard work and luck and all those intersections that are supposed to meet. Timing's the big one. I think he was ready. I think he was excited." Reynolds added and that "we pitched him was enough of a divergence from the character that he told and the character that he's left behind. It gives him something completely new to play, something he's really excited to do." Jackman previously told Cyrus XM that his Wolverine return was contingent on not messing up with events of Logan, and featured the deaths of Wolverine that Jackman had played since 2000's X-Men. Both fans and Jackman himself have long considered Logan the perfect conclusion for Wolverine. It's all because of this device that they have in the Marvel world of moving world around timelines. Jackman said, all but confirming that the multiverse plays a factor in his return. "Now we can go back because you know it's science, so I don't have to screw with Logan's timeline, which is important to me. And I think probably to the fans too." Reynolds said as much as in September, shortly after Jackman's Wolverine return was announced, the actor behind Deadpool stressed to the fans, "Logan takes place in 2029. Totally separate thing. Logan dies in Logan, not touching that." Jackman spoke exclusively to the Variety in October about his excitement over playing Wolverine once more. "A little part of me now thinks I'd be better at it," he said. "Is that arrogance of age or something? Wolverine's a tortured character, more tortured than me, but I always feel the feeling of him comfortable in his own skin now, even though it's messier. Deadpool 3 is gearing up for a May 2023 production start. The film is set to be in the theaters on November 8, 2024 from Disney. Next up, Kobi Kitano Takeshi's Cannes-bound period action film picked up by Kadokawa. Leading Japanese film studio Kadokawa has picked up all the rights to Kobi, the upcoming film by Kitano Takeshi, which will have its premiere out of competition in the Cannes. Kadokawa will handle both the international sales and the Japanese commercial release. The film depicts the historical Honnoji accident from 1482, where a key vassal of Oda Nobunaga rose in revolt and caused his master to commit harakiri in Kyoto. The reason for the revolt and whether Akechi Mitsude was really the ringleader have been debated ever since. The film will explore the ambitions, betrayals, fates of the various characters, including war lords, ninja, shambling performers, peasants, and bring out the essence of Kitano's world, including intense violence and dark humor. Speaking at a press conference over the weekend, Kitano explained that the film is based solely on the understanding of what the period and the people were about, and will definitely not be pretty picture and uplifting moments. Kitano has been planning to make this film for about 30 years. He says it was conceived around the same time as his, and in addition to directing, the movie wrote the original novel and screenplay himself. It's a rare film, on a scale similar to Akira, Kurosawa, The Seven Samurai, and Kagemusha, with a tragic comedy quality that feels Shakespearean, said Natsuno Takeshi, president and representative director of Kadokawa. The film was made with a budget of JPY 1.5 billion, far bigger than most Japanese movies, and stars Asano, Tadanobu, Nishijima, Hidetoshi, and Kase Ryo, who have name recognition abroad among a large ensemble cast. A Cannes selection for his latest PR Plus, but an award in the competition which has so eluded him, despite past wins of Silver and Golden Lions at Venice, could obviously be a bigger boost. Kitano has won Golden and Silver Lions at Venice for 1997 film Hanabi and for 2003 Zatoichi respectively, and saw him 2017 film Outrage final chapter selected as the Venice closing film, but he so far has failed to score top honors at Cannes. Last but not the least, let's talk about some serious news. All the Mandalorian Season 4 news that we've heard so far, the season has come to an end with a small army of Mandalorians leading an all-out assault on Moff Gideon's Imperial forces to reclaim their former homeworld. But now that the dust from the battle has settled, it's time to look at the future of Din, Djarin, and Grogu for what their journey might include next, and what we might have seen them again. Disney and Lucasfilm haven't revealed too much about the Mandalorian's fourth season yet, but here's what we know everything about the season 4 so far. According to the series creator Jon Favreau, the Mandalorian is already definitely getting a fourth season, and he's already written the scripts. That said, we don't know when it's set for release, or even when it might start shooting, but we do know what fits neatly is that Dave Filoni's Ahsoka series, which will be telling another part of an overarching story. With more than a year between season 2 and season 3, we might be waiting a little while before the next season of The Mandalorian arrives on Disney Plus. It seems like a solid guess what we could have it in sometime 2025. What will be the season all about? This is hard to say without knowing when it's coming out or what's on the horizon before, but it's safe to say it will have something to do with Thrawn, since he's going to be an important part of the upcoming Ahsoka series. The Mandalorian Season 4 could even involve Ezra Bridger, Gara Zeb-Zeb, Aurelius, the Sabine Wren for the same reason. But we're still a long way off of knowing any of that for sure. Next up, the Burrow, Stranger Things creator the Duffer Brothers is bringing new Supernatural series to Netflix. Netflix announced it will produce The Burrows, an upcoming supernatural mystery executively produced by Stranger Things creator Matt and Ross Duffer. The show, was created by the Dark Crystal Age of Resistance veterans Jeffrey Edis and Will Matthews, and centers on a character just a bit older than the gang from Hawkins, Indiana. The streaming service teases in an unseemingly picturesque retirement community in New Mexico. A group of unlikely heroes must band together to stop an otherworldly threat from stealing one thing they don't have, time. The Duffer Brothers, enthused, we've been fans of Jeff and Will's writing for a long time, and when they pitched us the idea for the Burrows, we immediately knew that they had something very special on their hands. They added, while the heroes in the Burrows have a few more years on them than the kids of the Stranger Things, they're similarly lovable bunch of misfits. We can't wait for you to join them on an adventure that stays funny, scary, and deeply touching. Buckle up, Twilight fans. The beloved book series turned blockbuster film franchise may be becoming a small screen near you. Lionsgate Television, in the early stages of developing a television adaptation of the Stephanie Meyer's best-selling Twilight saga. What to know about it? While the series is still in its infancy and doesn't have a network or platform attached, Lionsgate plans to lead the development before shopping the rights to potential buyers. The project's timeline is also up in the air. Some exciting news: Meyer herself will take part in the television adaptation. Plus, Y. Gottfried and former Lionsgate Motion Picture co-president Eric Faye will executively produce the show. Fun fact, Gottfried's Temple Hill banner produced all five of the Twilight movies that Faye Summit Entertainment distributed. Supposedly, Sinéad's Dali will write the script for the series adaptation. Some may know her other work, which includes Tell Me Lies and Walking Dead. For Lionsgate, Twilight is a major player in their library. The studio's CEO, John Feltimer, wants to expand the series with both the Twilight and Hunger Games franchise. The news of a Twilight TV series comes as Lionsgate negotiates with multiple bidders for a potential spin-off. As of the third quarter, the studio business has grown from 25% to $900 million. It's still early days for the Twilight series. There's no timeline when it will be taken to buyers. However, it's sure to get fans of the series excited for potential for more stories. It's the strength of the fan base that keeps it going, keeps your eyes peeled for more updates. In this excitement development, who knows, maybe we'll be spooning over Edward and Jacob all over again in no time. Is The Diplomat a true story? Netflix series starring Georgia Henley, Kerry Russell explained. The Diplomat is a political thriller which uses real-life references to bring story to life. The much-awaited political thriller Diplomat was finally released on Netflix on April 21. In a span of just one day, it registered itself in the list of most-watched series on OTT giant Netflix, including India. Created by Deborah Kahn, The Diplomat revolves around Hollywood actress Kerry Russell, who plays the character of Kate Weiler, a diplomat. The Diplomat is a multi-star series in which fans will witness actors like Rufus Sewell, Georgia Henley, David Gyasi, Ollie Ahn, Roni Kinnear, Aso Esado, and more. The Diplomat portrays almost real-life incidents. The story is a work of fiction, a political thriller, but uses real-life references to bring the story to life. Netflix, The Diplomat creator Deborah Kahn was inspired to write the series after meeting the US ambassador while she was writing for Homeland. The Foreign Service in the first and last of the ever disaster in the world, and nobody knows who they are to. Kahn told Netflix to Doom. Kahn had further said she was particularly drawn to the idea of couples who work together in Foreign Service. You're in a situation where the person you love the most is also somebody you're competing with all the time. It is pertinent to mention here that to keep the show's background and location real, Diplomat has been shot at the US Embassy in London, and the building really does look like a modernist cube designed by Kieran Timberlake. And the US ambassador to the UK does live in Winfield House in Regent's Park. The Diplomat is about an act of diplomacy, an effort to avoid a war between the UK and Iran, which could easily become a war involving numerous other countries, including the US. As the start of the series, US diplomat Kate Weiler is preparing to begin her role as an ambassador to Afghanistan when a British aircraft carrier HMS Courageous is attacked in the Persian Gulf. off the coast of Iran. Numerous British service men are killed, and White House calls Kate in a briefing where the president and chief of staff inform about her trip to Kabul. Zoff. Instead, she'll become the US ambassador to the UK, a role she very much does not want, given the chief of staff puts it the job's ceremonial component in Washington needs someone in London to offer condolences on their behalf, given the importance of the US-UK alliance and to stop a war before it starts. Turns out, Kate's the perfect fit. She has serious suspicions that Iran was behind the deaths on the courageous and is determined to uncover not only motivations behind the bombing, but the real culprit. She's sure it's the only way to avoid a tragedy spurred by faulty intelligence. Both UK Prime Minister Nicole Sawbridge and the US Vice President are eager to prove their mettle in the face of foreign attack and to win public support. Their recklessness is not just toxic, but catching. Iran doesn't make sense as the aggressor, but if UK were to retaliate, the situation would become an all-out crisis. Together with the British Foreign Secretary Austin Dennison and her own crew of US Embassy and CIA officials, Kate is tasked with managing Sawbridge's thirst for action while judging the Secretary of State's dissatisfaction with her and still unconfirmed source of the courageous strike. In the midst of the main conflict are two other sub-conflicts, one between Kate and the government and one between Kate and her husband. The White House wants Kate to replace their soon-to-be disgraced VP. Kate has no interest in the job. Kate wants a divorce from her husband, Hall, who wants to stay together. Oh, and another issue, the vice presidency and divorce don't tend to exist amicably in the same sentence. That's it for today's show. Thank you for watching and stay tuned till in the next time for more news about film, music and series. Don't forget to like, subscribe, comment our show so you never miss an episode. I'm Sana and this has been the Tittle-Tattle Show.